Thank you very much, Margaret, and good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm a bit disappointed that you don't understand this, and because I was banking on you to give the explanation. But I'll try and avoid the jargon. But first, thank you very much for the Commission for inviting me to speak here today. The last time I was in Northern Ireland was about 15 or 20 years ago, so it's long overdue to come back. The big mistake was taking advantage of the hostelry across from the hotel. That's why I'm not standing up there in case I fall off. But is it any reason why we're in the Europa Hotel? Is it a subtle hint from the Commission that perhaps the UK is part of Europe? But we've shot that UKIP fox. Cameron has shot the fox. He's now focused on much more important things like gay marriage and things like that. I don't know where we're going in politics. By the way, it's Chatham House rules, yeah? Chatham House rules, you can't quote me on all of this stuff, so I can be deliberately indiscreet. But no, it was my privilege, and my thanks to the Commission again, my privilege to chair an expert panel, which was tasked at looking at service innovation. And I'm delighted that Will Jansen is here to be with me again, because he was a key part of preparing that report. Anything that you don't like in it, it was Will's fault. Anything you do like it, I wrote it. But this group of people which the Commission brought together to look at service innovation came from a wide range of areas. Some of us were policymakers, some businessmen, others, I think, were straight politicians. And the discussion that we had over a period, well, it was a period of about a year, in a series of workshops, was really looking at the topics. When we were looking at these topics, we all felt that service innovation was everywhere. You're surrounded by it. And the critical question was, in a way, what was the role of government in this space, and what was the role of business? And I've been talking to a colleague here on this table who's studying the service innovation models in hotels. And in our discussions, we were looking at retail, we were looking at hotels and the like. And I suppose from our perspective, that was very much the preserve of business. And what we were trying to look at was what was driving change in society, and what was the role of government in helping business and helping society cope with that change. And we quickly came to the conclusion, when you look at the scale of change that's taking place, the challenges which we face in society, whether it's energy and carbon emissions, whether it's the congestion in towns and cities, whether it's an aging society, we quickly came to the view that individual interventions, if you want to call them projects, if you want to call it technology, those individual specific interventions might play a part, but by no means the solution to the problem. In no way could a new gizmo solve the problems of an aging population and the healthcare needs of those people or congestion. And the critical thing that we were looking at was, how was the system going to adapt? How was the system going to change? And perhaps even more importantly, how are the people in that system going to change? Because it's really all about behavioral change. You can put as many motorways in as you like. You can put as many sensors in on those motorways as you like. But if you just keep putting people driving down the motorway, you're still going to get the congestion at some stage or other. And in healthcare, you can produce whatever medicines you like, but if people are eating the wrong food and drink, he says, and if they're not taking exercise, if you don't change their behaviours, you're going to end up with obesity and diabetes as a result of that. So this panel was really looking at what was going to change behaviours and what was the systemic change that was needed. And that really brought us to the whole concept of large-scale demonstrators, because you don't really understand how a community will change unless you actually experiment on it. The community becomes the research laboratory itself. Just as in aerospace, in material science, you need a laboratory to test the way a material responds to heat and whatever. So with policy change, you need to have confidence and you need to experiment in the way people react to changes in that system. And we developed this idea that the role of government was innovation requires innovative government, and it was to allow a space, literally a space, a geographical space, for those pilots, because you're not going to bet the farm on something which has not been tried and tested. So you start with pilots, but then you need to scale up, because as we all know, we have hundreds, if not thousands, of pilots in our own economies, and they go nowhere. The critical thing is to move from the pilot stage to the demonstrator stage and learn and understand what works and what doesn't work. And demonstrators are not you might think it a misnomer that you're demonstrating success. Actually, it's still an experiment. The group here today, you may fail. The crucial thing is to learn from that failure and then move on and share that failure with others. So the large-scale demonstrator concept was really taking pilots to the stage where both government, policymakers, and business can understand what works and what doesn't work, to give them the confidence to move to roll out. So the large-scale demonstrator, what is large-scale? It's a scale which enables both sides to take that next step of rollout. If you don't feel confident about the size and the complexity that you're grappling with, then you've not gone large enough. Equally, if you try and take a whole city, you may have gone too large, unless it's a small city. So the whole concept of large-scale demonstrators is really about testing ideas and having the confidence to test ideas and learn from those mistakes and see how society adapts and responds to the new systems that you're putting in place. And in a way, there's nothing new in that. If you actually take a historical perspective, that's how innovation has always happened. I mean, whether you go back to Gutenberg and his Bible, and Caxton stealing his idea and bringing it to London, he was using the knowledge that he had developed out in Strasbourg and in the Rhineland and brought it back to London. But he had learned from the mistakes of Gutenberg, or he'd adapted what Gutenberg had done and developed it in his own market. Gutenberg, as we all know, developed Bibles. But we British, or we English, we're not very religious. Latinate Bibles, we're not going to sell like hot cakes in London, that was for sure. What Caxton did was he decided that the market opportunity of this new printing press was novels, was books. But he had a problem, because English in the 15th century was not a unified language. We talk of the language of Shakespeare. Actually, Caxton, 100 years before, English is the language of Caxton. He had to standardize the language. The people of Kent, just south of the River Thames, could not understand the people in Essex, north of the River Thames. Just as I don't understand people in the northeast of England today, here in England of those days, there was a massive problem of dialect. So he had to standardize the English language in order to upscale and capitalize on his knowledge. And Caxton, as a result, became a very rich man. Gutenberg, I think, died not so rich. But you can take that example forward and look at the transformation of the transport system, which started with Stevenson, which started from Stockton to Darlington. The railway from Stockton to Darlington is just 9 miles. It's a pilot. And it was a railway built predominantly for the transport of coal. And the crucial thing was they learned from that experience, and Stevenson then had the opportunity to build a railway from Liverpool to Manchester, 30 miles. And what he found was that the market for railways was not just about the transport of coal or cotton and raw materials. He found it was the transport of people. That was almost by accident. In his original plans, he was not thinking about people. But then in the trials for the railway, he discovered an excitement. Traveling at 20 miles an hour, safely, well, relatively safely, even 30 miles an hour, it was an excitement. It was like a fun fair ride. And the people took to it, and the upshot was that the railway system expanded from those early, if you like, demonstrators and rolled out across the country and rolled out across Europe. And Similarly, you can take these ideas forward. By the way, the key point on the railways was also standards. Two standards about the success of the railway. First standard was a technology standard. About after 10 years, they realized they had two gauges, a broad gauge and a standard gauge. And at Swindon, the crowds were getting off the trains and there was mayhem. It was carnage as they were having to change to get onto the different gauge. So they introduced a standard gauge. But the other interesting standard was England at the time was not very accustomed to keeping time, a bit like conferences. And there was no concept of time, but railways needed to have time, a timetable. And so Greenwich Mean Time became the agreed time, and all it became railway time. And so the clocks always worked on Greenwich Mean Time to allow the railways to operate efficiently. So standards, again, was critical. But as you look through history, you see that this whole concept of demonstrators keeps reappearing. So it's nothing new, whether it's Rowland Hill and the penny post. We had a penny post. It was within London. It was within Bristol. It was within Glasgow. The novelty of Rowland Hill was he changed the business model. Hill's great innovation was not cash on delivery, because that was what was costing all the money. It was hugely expensive to deliver post in those days, because you had to go and find the person who's going to receive the letter. And what Rowland Hill discovered was that was where the cost lay, so he went cash in advance. And we'd all businessmen here love to work on cash in advance. So that was the great innovation, the business model innovation of the 19th century, that he changed and he slashed the price from 6 pence down to half a pence. But bringing us right up to the modern day, what gave us our inspiration was actually Steve Jobs, because here again, he's completely transformed the service model, completely transformed the system. The technology there is not really his. What he's done is knitted it together in a beautiful design and changed the business model so that now you can buy your music online for a fraction instead of going to get a hard disk. And the key message that we took from Jobs' experience was technology is important, but actually it's the customer experience which is the key, and you work back to the technology. You don't start with the technology and work forward. And that, I suppose, was really the policy lesson that we learned. That as policymakers, we tend to give the citizen what we think is good for them, rather than allowing the citizen to inform and help us develop the service system that he or she needs. And again, we tend to think in terms of the technology rather than working back to the technology to deliver what the citizen needs. So this expert panel drew its conclusions, I think, fairly succinctly around the importance of systemic change, the importance of government's key role in changing the service systems which impact upon the citizen, recognizing that in many areas it's for the private sector and the private sector alone to change those systems. As I say, whether it's hotels, whether it's retail, or whether it's Steve Jobs and that whole internet. Interoperable standards come through again, and it's government's job to help facilitate the standards which will enable a truly competitive and a larger market to develop. So that was the work of the panel, and I'm delighted that the Commission has been able to take on board its findings and to pursue quite aggressively this idea of demonstrators and push this agenda in the Commission. I should say that as a policymaker, I too am pushing it in the UK, in my own policy making. And you may have seen that we are going forward with the idea of large-scale demonstrators ourselves. The Technology Strategy Board launched a competition, a Future Cities demonstrator competition last year. It was quite clever in its approach. I thought it was stupid, but no, in retrospect, it was quite clever. We all learn. It launched a feasibility studies, £50,000 feasibility studies, and offered grants to cities that were willing to take up the challenge, and 30 cities did. And the reason they did was because it then had a £24 million prize for the winner. It's quite a jump from 50,000 to 24 million. Did Belfast had a bash at it? Lots of, 30 cities had a bash at this. The slight problem with this is you get one winner and 29 losers. But they're not losers, actually, because what we found, and this is the smartness, I think, of the Technology Strategy Board's approach, it galvanised massive interest. This 50,000 galvanised huge interest with the prize, the lottery prize of 24 at the end of it, the one winner takes all. And all these cities really developed serious attempts to understand how they could transform their systems of systems. And then there were four shortlisted, and eventually Glasgow won the prize. But the cities I've spoken to, and the companies in the cities that were working in partnership with the local authorities, they've always said, for God's sake, don't stop. This was a valuable experience, and we can see our way forward. And we'll just have to do it at a slightly slower pace with less resource. But the companies are urging the local government not to give up on it just because Glasgow is the sole winner. And that, I think, is the smartness of that approach, that it galvanised interest. And my challenge now as a policymaker is I'm working on an industrial strategy and smart cities. I'm leading on that theme of smart cities. And I got the challenge of, how do I take this game forward from now on? Do I go for another demonstrator, get another 30 applicants, one winner, 29 losers? I don't think I will. I think the key is smaller sums and see if we can pick on some key elements of a smart city to demonstrate how a particular aspect needs to change. And then I think my thinking is we take it from there. But again, in this work on smart cities, people are not saying to me, it's technology. Yes, it's infrastructure, of course, but no one's saying it's technology. What they're saying is it's standards, interoperable standards, and it's really a joined upness within government to make it happen. It's all siloed thinking. And the challenge of a smart city is how you join all that up. It's culture, it's the culture of the city, and a willingness to share. So that's where we in government are taking it, and certainly in the budget submissions, we have put in for a budget of about 100 million on demonstrators, because we see demonstrators as being a key policy tool now to take forward new ideas in a way which helps us understand behavioural change and that. So just to conclude now, because I know you want me to keep me to time. Yeah. Well, that's fantastic. To conclude, what do I want from this particular conference and workshop? What do I want from this particular exercise? And I do hope that the lucky winners will have that vision that you're talking about, that they will share their experience, and crucially, but the onus, I think, is actually as much on the evaluators, the consultants working with the teams involved, to develop the tools that we can all use to go forward. Because that, to me, is the advantage of the demonstrator approach and a European demonstrator approach. The whole concept was not around just a demonstrator and that's it. It was about linked demonstrators and learning from each other. Because that is the value of a European community, is that we share that experience and learn from the different environments that we're in. So I do hope that that's captured by the evaluators, the assessors, and then enables us to share that learning and that experience for the good of all. And I suppose my concluding point is that the teams, the responsibility does lie with the winning teams. And you kind of have my sympathy as well, because the first prize, as I understood it, was that you had 3 or 4 days consulting, was it, from chemo? 3 or 4 days consulting from chemo was the first prize. The second prize was 8 to 10 days consulting from chemo. And the booby prize was actually being sort of 10 days from Hugo Hollander's. That's the real booby prize. No, more seriously, is these guys are the ones who have to capture the knowledge and the experience and then tell me how it's done, and I will tell the British government what they should be doing next. So on that happy note, with 1 minute to go, thank you very much indeed for your attention, and I too wish you a very successful conference. Thank you.